Good morning. We are glad to be here, and we're glad that you are as well. I'm without Regan this morning, but the wonderful and beautiful Simpson will be helping me in a moment. We are glad. It is such a beautiful day. What an amazing weekend it's been. Yesterday was a phenomenal day with Faith in Action and a number of other things, and we're just, well, we're glad that you're with us. So Simpson, who's in the back, right now, do we have any names?
We got Dorothy Wood.
Good morning, Bill and Dorothy. Thank you for being with us and your patience.
Good morning,
Eunice. Thank you for your help yesterday with the as part of the missions committee. I think it was a great day. Anyone else? Good morning, Roz. Thank you also for being there yesterday. Peace be with you as well, Felicity. One of the best things about yesterday, just pausing the names for a second, was seeing people for the first time in 15 months, and it was quite a lot of fun just trying to guess who people were with their masks and their long COVID hair. It was a lot of fun, and Felicity showed up and started taking some pictures. So hopefully we'll see lots of pictures of yesterday's activities in next month's newsletter. So it's good to have you with us, Felicity. Simpson, anyone else?
Robin from Patrick, and good morning, friends. Glad to be working
with you. Well, thank you, Robin. And Susie, thank you so much, Robin, for all that you did with Faith in Action. So yeah, it's good that you're with us. Hopefully you got your feet up. Good morning, Doreen and Ray. Thank you also for being with us. Thank you, Ray, for setting up the prayer vigil. I believe we just covered St. Andrews as well as everything else we prayed for from all day long. It was wonderful. Thank you.
Good morning,
Ann. We're glad that you're able to be with us. Good morning to all the BIMs. Thank you. Good morning. Good, thank you. Good sunny morning to you too, Colin and June and Betty.
Susan Jess, good morning.
Speaking of mystery people, Susan Jess, I think you won the award of guess who was who, but it was great to see you. I'm sure you were smiling behind the mask going, I don't think these people recognize me, but it was great that you were there and helping out. So thank you, Susan.
Susan McGugan.
Good morning, Susan McGugan. It's great to have you with us. And Paul, thank you for your work yesterday as well. Everything outside looks great.
John, Helen, Paul, good morning to you all.
Good morning, John and Helen, and good morning to all of you there.
Muriel, good morning to
Taylor. Good morning, Jim and Muriel. We hope that you guys are well.
Catherine Haney, Betty.
Oh, you've changed it. So it's Catherine, Kathy, Bainey, Hetty.
Catherine Haney, Betty.
Okay. Good. So if you weren't here, Catherine came and came down to be with us to drop some stuff off, and it was so good to see her. And just like at the dog park where you're only known by your pet's name, it was great to meet Milo's mom. So good to see you, and good morning, Milo. Ah, wearing your Habs jerseys. Or it's too warm for those. Anyway, good to have you with us.
Good morning,
Brigida and Frank. Brigida, thank you for your help yesterday. It was very, many hands made light work.
Tim Knox and Jean Dupree, say
good morning. Good morning to Kim and Jean. Good morning to Kim and Jean. Thank you also for coming down. It was great to see you guys. Again, we had a number of people driving distances to be with us to take part in Faith in Action, and it was just great to be able to reconnect. So thank you for coming.
Grace, Mr. Yates. Good morning.
Good morning, Grace and Ken, and we are glad that you are watching. Speaking of distances, bonjour. Mike and Molly, we are glad that you are with us on the banks of the St. Lawrence out there in the La Belle Province. Yeah. Well, good morning to you, Kim. We're glad that you're with us. Pick a good one. Five more. Be quick. Good morning, Janet, in this, and to the Sukalals.
We have Philip Paul saying,
what? What's that? Is there any, if, please let us know if you're having sound problems. Yeah. Good morning, Mother. It is good to have you with us. I was told by a number of people yesterday that they always enjoyed it when you showed up, and I got to say good morning to you. So it is good to have you with us. Let's move on. We do have a couple of announcements. I just wanted to let people know that and to thank everyone who took part in the elder election. We counted the ballots on Thursday evening, and I don't want to say it misquoted, but we had 90 ballots, which is almost double of what we had at the last election. So thank you to everyone who contributed and took the time to fill it out and to resend it. We also, on those 90 ballots, had about 460 votes. Not everyone filled out all six, but that's great, that's fine. And out of that 460 or so votes, we had about 94 individuals nominated. So, if you get a call from me for a cup of coffee, you know what it's going to be about. But you're not going to hear from me just yet. The session will be meeting tomorrow night, and we'll be reviewing the list. And we hope that you will consider a call to serve on the session if and when it comes. But I just want to say thank you again to everyone who took part in that. Secondly, I've already mentioned it. Faith in Action was yesterday. The weekend service projects were yesterday, and a great big thank you to Robin and to the mission team, the committee, who helped put the everything together and oversee it. I know Eunice was very involved, Brigitte, Blanche. We had a lot of people who were there. the WMS was involved. It was wonderful. So thank you, thank you, thank you to everyone. And to all of you who donated. So please, faith in action is a great thing for us to do, but we should be putting our faith in action every day. So hopefully this will carry forward as we go forward in the year to come. That's it for the announcements. I just want to get to some birthdays because it is a busy week for birthdays. And so just this week coming up, we have John Baccarin, Jennifer Flint, Simpson Ross. Yay, there she is putting her hands up. Richard Allion's birthday is also this week. And guess what? Richard got married last week. So Richard's getting everything done in the month of June. Apparently, he's also finishing off his dissertation, and so we wish Richard all the best in this month, and a happy birthday to him. Carol White, Naf Massey are also having their birthday. Victoria Durer is going to be having a birthday, and also happy birthday to you, Betty Moore, who I believe is on the phone with Colin and June. So to everybody there, I pray that God will bless you with health and happiness in the year to come. Sadly, we also have some deaths just to report. Roy Singh, Jasmine Singh's oldest son, passed away on Thursday as a result of an accident. And the family has asked for prayers. And right now, just to let you know that there are no plans for a public funeral. So we are deeply saddened by this death as the Singh family is still wrestling with and dealing with Jasmine's death. Yes, Simpson. Yul Batty's relative, Yosef Balush, also passed away in Pakistan, and the funeral will be tomorrow. And Yul has been asking for prayers for Yosef's family as well as Yul's family as they mourn Yosef's passing. So we are deeply saddened for your death as well as the fact that you cannot travel to be with them. So thank you for letting us know about the death. And if you have any other prayer requests, please, you can post them on the Facebook feed or connect with our prayer at standrews.ca email, and that will help you get onto our prayer circle. Speaking of prayer, let's take a moment in silent prayer and meditation as we prepare to start our service. Amen.
Did you mention his birthday?
Whose?
Yul.
It's Yul's birthday as well?
On the 10th.
Oh, my apologies, Yul. It was also your birthday. Happy birthday to you. I invite Simpson to come and help light the Christ candle.
We light the Christ candle. Oh, do we? We light the Christ candle to remind us that Jesus is the light of the world.
Friends, as a community committed to loving God by loving our neighbors, to learning to know God's love through worship and study and prayer, let us put our faith into action by loving and caring for each other, using God's gifts to go forth to bring others to Christ. As sisters and brothers bound by love, the love that comes from God, let us gather to know God together and greet one another in Christ. Let us together give thanks and worship the God of all hope by joining our voices in praise and in prayer. Let us pray using a hymn based on Psalm 91. Whoever clings to God in love, God will protect and guard. Seek then a refuge from above when life is fierce and hard. Angels will have us in their charge, bearing us lest we fall. God will our sense of life enlarge, answering when we call. In every trouble, God is near, granting us strength to cope. God will deliver us from our fear, filling our lives with hope. Let us give thanks for the length of days which God in love imparts. We celebrate God's saving ways, giving to God our minds and our hearts. Amen. Our time of confession gives us an opportunity to write our relationship with God and to recognize that sin has indeed stained our lives. If we think we have no sin in us, we deceive ourselves. In the midst of the disappointment and fear and despair of our lives, I know, if you're anything like me, we doubt and we question God's plan and purpose for us, choosing to place our trust and our hope into the things and the ways of this world. Yet Paul says this, that God's love and God's grace is the only source of our hope, a hope that conquers all our fears and overcomes all our doubts, a hope that produces endurance and character and offers to us life, a living hope offered to us in and through Jesus Christ our Lord. The question is for us is, how have we responded to this eternal promise offered to us by God? As we think on that, let us gather before God to seek God's forgiveness by confessing our sins first in the unison prayer of confession printed in the bulletin, then in the language, the silent language of our hearts. Let us pray together. God of hope, you lived as one of us. You know us. You know all our doubts, all our fears and flaws. You have heard our broken promises and experienced our anger. You have seen us at our worst, yet in your love you died for us. Forgive our lack of trust, our faltering faith, our wanting hope. By your Spirit, speak to us of your promises and plans for us. Remind us of your sacrifice and of your offer of eternity, that we may be emboldened to place our hope in you, the one true hope that does not disappoint. Amen. Friends in Christ, hear and believe the good news. The good news of God's saving grace is told to us by Paul, saying, "The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance. For to this end we toil and struggle, because we have our hope on the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially those who believe." Thanks be to God for the gift of this gift of grace. One for us in and through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Let us now join together in the hymn number 814, which you will find in your PDF worship bulletin. Morning has broken, and you can't say you don't know this one. So let us hear hymn 841, Morning Has Broken. Thank you.
me in saying the unison prayer for illumination as it is printed in the worship bulletin PDF. Let us pray. Holy God, in these hard times, we yearn to be reassured of your promises for us. By your Spirit, open our ears that we might be emboldened by your words of hope. Amen. We continue our summer series on hope, in which we are looking at how we are to live in hope in God, in and through Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. But even at the best of times, hope can be elusive and fleeting, especially after 15 months of the COVID-19 pandemic. It is even harder to hold on to. This series is meant to remind us of our hope, the hope that is founded on Christ and the love/grace of God, a hope that does not disappoint us. As we prepare to read and listen to God's word, let us be attentive, for God is speaking. Today's reading is from the book of Lamentations, chapter 3, verses 1 to 31. God's steadfast love endures. I am one who has seen affliction under the rod of God's wrath. He has driven and brought me into darkness without any light. Against me alone, he turns his hand again and again all day long. He has made my flesh and my skin waste away and broken my bones. He has besieged and enveloped me with bitterness and tribulation. He has made me sit in darkness like the dead of long ago. He has walled me about so that I cannot escape. He has put heavy chains on me. Though I call and cry for help, he shuts out my prayer. He has blocked my ways with hewn stones. He has made my paths crooked. He is a bear lying in wait for me, a lion in hiding. He led me off my way and tore me to pieces. He has made me desolate. He bent his bow and set me as a mark for his arrow. He shot into my vitals the arrow of his quiver. I have become the laughingstock of all my people, the object of their taunt songs all day long. He has filled me with bitterness. He has sated me with wormwood. He has made my teeth grind on gravel and made me cower in ashes. My soul is bereft of peace. I have forgotten what happiness is. So I say, gone is my glory and all that I had hoped for from the Lord. The thought of my affliction and my homelessness is wormwood and gall. My soul continually thinks of it and is bowed down within me. But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for one to bear the yoke in youth, to sit alone in silence where the Lord has imposed it, to put one's mouth to the dust, there may yet be hope, to give one's cheek to the smiter and be filled with insults, for the Lord will not reject forever. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Simpson, for helping us with that reading. It is, it's quite the reading. It is one of those passages in the Bible that when you read it, you think, wow. As an English major, first off, I think, wow, those are some wonderful words. The power of the language, the idea of all of what has been going on and befalling this individual as he is lamenting, hence Lamentations, God's sense of absence in his life. And I can say there must certainly over time, any time in our lives, we have all at some point or another felt that God has either abandoned us or is absent or is not listening to our pleas. And it is not true. What this person is saying is, even though all things are bad and things just keep seemingly getting worse, even in the midst of all that has bowed this person down, He says this, I call this to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, for great is God's faithfulness. Friends, if there's one thing I can offer to you and have been praying for you, is that over the past 15 months and in the uncertainty of the time to come ahead, as maybe things reopen or the roller coaster that we're on with that, but also just in terms of re-entering into life and society, my prayer for you is that no matter what happens, that you will remember that saying, that God's steadfast love never ceases and that his mercies never come to an end, and they are new every morning, for great is God's faithfulness. Please always know that in God we have hope, and that hope is renewed daily. No matter what is going on, I can promise you that God is paying attention and God is watching. I just wanted to mention before it got too far along, we received a note saying that Lisa Castellano's birthday was yesterday. So I just want to say happy birthday to you, Lisa. I'm sorry I was going on the list and I just may have missed your name, but happy birthday to you, and we are glad that you're with us. So right now we are continuing our, as Simpson said, our Hope series. And one of the things that I'm just going to give a little background for a second, because in many ways, in our world, a lot of what we do in terms of our mindset has been shaped by our history. And for centuries, this is not a new thing, for centuries, more or less since the Enlightenment, everything in our culture, everything in our business, everything in the world that we have has been shaped by this ideal that everything is going up and to the right. For me, this is the right, but probably for you, this is the right, but up and to the right, which is, in the marketing terms, that means that things are going, profits are going up and productivity is getting better. Everything is going up and to the right, meaning that things, there's prosperity, that there's success, that things are getting better. And in many ways, just to simplify it, that has been the image and the goal for centuries. And as a result, for centuries, we've had progress. There was the, as I said, the Enlightenment, and out of that came an ideal of economic growth, and that there was this sense of a progression to human history, that we were evolving and getting better, that human achievement seemed set, that things were, there was nothing that we couldn't do. So what could go wrong? Well, the 1900s turned around and we had first one world war, then we had a pandemic, a global pandemic, then we had a global economic depression, then we had a second world war, then we had nuclear war, then we had the Cold War, and all sorts of things just seemed to happen. And W.H. Auden wrote a poem in the late 40s, and the poem itself, while it was basically a book length, it was in four parts, the title of the poem seemed to sum up what was happening post-World War II going into the 50s, which was had gone from the age of enlightenment and prosperity to the age of anxiety. That was the new reality. And since then, globalization and international capitalism has created in our world an inequity of wealth and worth. It has created countless wars. Terrorism has been on the rise. Man-made problems have just seemed to proliferate, and only things are getting worse. And in many ways, we, because of this ideal of human advancement, we've replaced God as the source of our hope. It is up to us to generate our hope. So, what went wrong? Well, Over the past 15 months with the COVID-19 pandemic, we've also endured health and economic concerns. There seems to be a growth of discontent and pessimism and division and racial suspicion. There's fear everywhere. The future no longer seems as rosy or as certain as it might have with that sense of up and to the right. Truth itself is even threatened. And if you're anything like me, it feels like we've lost something. So I just want to ask, how afraid are you right now about anything? And how hopeful are you right now? And as I ask those questions, I just want to let you know that just as the answer to the person in that reading we heard, God's faithfulness is steadfast, and God has an answer for us. And that answer is literally found in the Bible. 62 times, God and Jesus and angels say, "Do not be afraid." "Do not be afraid," said Abraham, God to Abraham in Genesis. "And do not be afraid," says Jesus to his frightened disciples as he is being crucified and after he's risen. "And do not be afraid," says the angel to those same disciples at the empty tomb and as he has risen and as they are waiting on the promise of the Spirit. The phrase, "do not be afraid," is God's answer, and it echoes throughout the Bible. It is spoken by God and Jesus and angels who are offering to us that solution to our fear. Why then don't we trust it? Or why don't we believe it? And why are we so afraid? Now, going back to that sort of overview of history, what's interesting is this modern sociologists believe that the ancient peoples, and we're talking ancient peoples, turned to God for hope because, as they said, they didn't understand the things they couldn't control. So that faith was, in essence, a superstition. But in reality, faith is about something deeper. Faith is not about controlling what is out there, the weather or other things. It's about what's controlling and dealing with what's in here, in our hearts, our minds, and in our lives. It's a search truly and simply for purpose and meaning. Progress in that enlightenment ideal or that corporate or business ideal is not about leaving faith. It's not even about faith. But the truth is, and I think this is the answer to what we've been missing, is that without faith, progress and the future lack hope. Because hope moves us beyond ourselves and our circumstance. Hope moves us towards love and mercy and grace and sacrificial relationships that make you and me and the world a better place. And so the Bible says over and over again, do not be afraid. And that's because it means believe me, trust me, have faith. This is God calling to us to place our faith, our belief, our trust, our hope in him. And do not be afraid, while it sounds easy, isn't. Especially in a world where we're afraid of the unknown that's out there. Because the world out there is scary and can be an evil place filled with violence and hatred. It's big and it's an impersonal world that we no longer understand or where we don't seem to matter. And we're also afraid of the unknown that's happening in our bodies. We're afraid of the shadows and the creases and the folds in that CAT scan, or of the aches and the pains and those things that grow exponentially or inexplicably. We're even fearful, especially over the last 15 months, of what we put into our mouths, or the food that we eat, or the water that we drink, and the air that we breathe, and even who we are around. Do not be afraid sounds simple, but it's not, especially for many today, because life today is a struggle in which our fears of the unknown have become a fear of almost everything. And as a result, we've chosen to blot out our fears with the many fixes available to us, choosing to live comfortably numb so that we don't have to be challenged by what we can't control, because we're afraid to let go or to change who we are, to change how we live. To this I say, do not be afraid, is God's way of saying he has an answer and an antidote to and for our fears. As I'm sure many of you know, I like wordplay, and there's a whole category of pun jokes called dad jokes, and I'm happy that people exchange these with me, but there's one that has always stuck with me, and it happened probably about 10, 15 years ago. I was in a coffee shop in Charlottetown, and it was one of those, I think it was a Timothy's, actually. I don't know if they're still around, but they had this large jar, it was a large oversized coffee mug on the counter, and it was right by the cash register, and it was full of loose change. Remember loose change? That was what was in it, and it had this little note that had been taped to the inside of the rim so that you could see it as they were handing you your change. The sign said this: if you fear change, leave it here. And so I did. And I thought to myself, wow, that is the answer, or one of our definitions for our faith. And it was easy for me to do. And it's the same thing that God is calling us to do when he says, do not be afraid. Why? Because God had a plan for us. And that plan was the cross. And the grace of the cross says we have nothing to fear. And if we do have anything to fear, we are then to leave it with him, with Jesus and God. Leave it at the foot of the cross and have faith and to have hope. You see, from the beginning, and in many ways that's how we hear it in the Lamentations reading, from the beginning the people of God knew and believed and lived out and in this hope, that God's steadfast love never ceases, that mercies would never come to an end, and that they would be new every morning. Think of the people in exile, or in the Exodus, with the manna that showed up every day, signs of how great God's faithfulness is. And later, the church and Christians in the first century, in the second century, in the third century of the church, distinguished themselves against the crises of history with it and their belief that life, that this life, is only transitory, is only part of a larger story, of God's story. And that gave Christians meaning and purpose and hope. And it should give each of us the same meaning and purpose of hope. And we know this because the word used in the New Testament, which is a Greek word that means not just hope, but profound certainty. And that word speaks to a belief and a hope that went beyond just mere wishful thinking. Christians, even in the hardest circumstances throughout time, knew and trusted and were confident in God's promised hope that was known in and through the resurrection of Jesus. And that as the foundation of their faith, their lives, and their hope. The Christians Peter writes to in our second reading, that is there in your bulletin, had already suffered various trials, but because of God's great mercy, they were given a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. This is our hope. This is our hope for forever. Yes, says Peter, as we know, this inheritance, this hope that they had came at a cost. Peter talks about trials and testing by fire and suffering. But the resurrection for us as an Easter people means that we have a hope for the future, not based on this world or on what we can do, but on a living hope, the living hope of God's mercy, grace, steadfast love, and promises. Friends, this hope, this belief, this profound certainty in the resurrection gives us a new birth into a life lived for the risen Jesus, into a faith in the resurrection, and how this gives us hope that will sustain us in and through anything, anything, even death. As Simpson said, this our summer series, the series on hope, is meant to remind us of our hope, the hope that is indeed founded on Christ and of the love and grace of God, a hope that does not disappoint us. But as we go forward, and as we go to the meal that we're about to receive, let the resurrection be the template and the foundation for your hope, a living hope in a living and risen Lord, a belief in God and God's promises made and promises kept, so that knowing this promised hope is and will be ours, so that it will enable us to live our lives not in fear, but in hope, even in hardship and even in hard times. Amen. Friends, as we continue our service, I just wanted to mention to you our appreciation for your steadfast faithfulness in terms of your offering. And we are reminded by Scripture that throughout time, God has made promises of hope. Through Christ's life, ministry, death, and resurrection, God fulfilled these promises. In Christ, we have been given many things: love, forgiveness, and grace. Our offerings are a sign of our thanksgiving and of our gratitude to the one who gave everything, even a living hope for an everlasting life. Freely we have received gifts of salvation and grace. Freely we shall return to God what is God's in our offering. Once again, thank you to everyone who has mailed in their offering or used our online options. We encourage you to use those online options, or if you don't want to mail it, you can contact myself or Kim Shepherd, the clerk, or Jean Bradshaw, the deputy clerk, and we'll arrange for a pickup. Now, as we continue our service, as we prepare to approach the table, let us hear the invitation to the table. Friends, in the name of the one true and eternal Lord, who called his disciples by name to follow him and God's ways, we too have come invited by the Holy Spirit, joyful and humbly, in response to God's glory and grace. This table is the joyful feast where Jesus has invited us to come. In this feast comes the root of our joy, the source of our hope. In this feast, in these elements, is retold God's story of our salvation. And in this feast, we are invited up and into communion with God through Christ. This is the table of the Lord. This is the promised feast prepared for us by our Lord Jesus Christ. So come, taste and see that the Lord is good. We will now hear our communion hymn, hymn number 528. Jesus calls us here to meet him, and you can find that in your worship PDF. As we prepare to receive God's gifts, let us join together in prayer as we pray for the gifts that have been received and also the gifts prepared for this meal. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God of hope, for the holy vine of your servant David, which you have revealed to us through your servant Jesus. To you is the glory forever. We give you thanks, O God, for the life and knowledge which you have revealed to us in and through your servant Jesus and by your Holy Spirit. To you be the glory forever. Just as this broken loaf was scattered over the hill as grain and having been gathered together became one, in like fashion may we as members of your church be gathered together from the various parts of our community and the ends of the earth into the body of Christ, into your kingdom. Because yours is the glory and the power through Jesus Christ, who won for us salvation forever. And amen to you, Holy God, as we join together saying the Lord's Prayer offered to us by your Son, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, and we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As we gather here before your table, O God. We come called by name and by our needs to your table that has been prepared by your hand. We come once again to listen to the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, who said on the night before he died, and he took bread and gave thanks, he broke it and said to his disciples, "Take this, this is my body that is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The bread of heaven. In the same way, he took the cup after supper and he said, "This cup is the new covenant that is sealed in my blood. Whenever you drink of it, you do so in remembrance of me." The cup of salvation and the bread of heaven. Come, taste and see that the Lord is good. Friends, he who was with God in the beginning is with us in this bread. He of whom the prophet spoke now speaks to us through this cup. Through this triumphant feast, God has come close to us so that we may come to know God together. Every time you eat of this bread and you drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Let us pray. We give you thanks, Holy God, for your holy name, which you have caused to dwell in our hearts, and for the knowledge and hope of our faith and the immortality which you have made known to us in your servant Jesus. To you be the glory forever. You, Almighty God, created all things for your name's sake and gave food and drink for all to enjoy, that they might give you thanks. But to us you have graciously given spiritual food and drink and the eternal promise of eternal life through your Son, Jesus. Above all, we give thanks because you are mighty, and to you be the glory forever. We pray, remember your church, Lord. Remember our congregation. Remember our denomination as it enters into a time of General Assembly for the next 4 days. And deliver it from all evil. Make it perfect in your love, and gather us and it so that we may know together you together and abound in your hope. We pray, build it up from the four winds so that it might be your body, able to do for your kingdom what you have prepared it and us for. For yours is the glory forever. Amen. Over there. There we go.
The light that was in one place at one time was changed so that it could be in all places at all times, in this room and in yours.
Friends, as we go out into the world, as you go out into the rest of this day and into the week to come, into the places where you may work, where you live, where you may greet others, may all that you say and do reflect a life lived in hope, a hope based on God's steadfast mercies that are new each and every day, a hope founded on the promise and the truth and the opportunity of the resurrection. And we pray this in Jesus Christ our Lord. And now, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be be with you today, now, and forevermore. Amen.